for just sharing some ideas. It's actually a great pleasure to speak to you as an audience. As you can see from my resume that's in your book, I actually began, as many of you did, starting my own venture. It was right out of school that a group of us put together at that time. It was a few $1,000s to launch a consulting firm that we had the great joy and pleasure of running and growing for many years. We sold that company to Computer Sciences in 1988, and I stayed with Computer Sciences for about 8 years to run their consulting and applications business, and then had the experience, actually, of working within a very large corporation. And then it was 1996 when Ross Perot Sr. was running for president that he asked some of us to come and to help really build what is now Perot Systems. And so I've been at Perot for about 13 years, seeing the development of a company that really was at about $300 to $400 million when I joined it, to as what Norm points out is now a $3 billion company. So I've had the great experience of actually smaller ventures, larger ventures, seeing small ventures grow to something big. But I must tell you that I think the most exciting part of my career was at the same time, the kind of time that you are all in, the building of an enterprise that you own, that you control, and that you have the joy and fun of running every day. I've also had the pleasure, as Don pointed out, of writing some books, not an easy enterprise these days. And in fact, the Outsmart book is for sale out there. I don't fortunately make a living selling books, but I'd be pleased to sign that book if any of you would like to buy one, although I should warn you that I've signed so many books in my lifetime, it's the unsigned ones that are rare. And so you can buy one signed or unsigned after the session. I want to talk to you today really about four things. First, very briefly, I want to add just my perspective on what you heard from Ram this morning. I thought that was just a very intelligent description of what's happened and the context in which we are operating. But I just want to add a couple of points to that. Secondly, I want to share with you what I've been doing for the last couple of years in terms of the research and work in preparation for the writing of this series of books that Norm mentioned. Third, I'd like to actually share some of the examples from this series of books and point out what I've learned from observing and studying the companies in the series of books. And then fourth, I started to write this series of books because I was really interested in looking at new business models. It was fundamentally changing in the nature of business. These books were not like the Reengineering book, which was a big idea book, but these were a series of books to really look and again and examine what was changing in the nature of business. And although I didn't go into the research with the expectation of finding a big single idea, what I did find was a set of shared characteristics and behaviors in these companies and what I consider to be particularly successful companies in developing new business models. And I want to share with you those shared behaviors, what I did find that I think was particularly unique about these high-growth companies, many of them, again, very similar to what you represent here in this room. So first, on the condition and on the context, just 2 points. I think you could go back a few years ago and actually easily predict if you were a student of business, the fact that we would be in some form of recession here in 2009. There was a very interesting piece of work done 30 years ago, work that should be revived. And for those of you who want to study the phenomenon of bubbles, should go back and read about. There's a piece of work done by a computer scientist by the name of Jay Forrester at MIT, at the MIT Sloan School, again, about 30, 40 years ago, in fact. A whole field of work called industrial dynamics. And what Forrester basically proved was that business is often built to an overcapacity because the feedback loops and the systems of business were slow. And businesses just built ahead, and never in fact slowed down when they should have. And it was very easy if you looked at retailing, if you looked at housing, if you looked at a lot of industries, you could see overcapacity building in the last several years. And you could also see that it was, of course, building because it was easily funded, as Ram pointed out. We had almost zero interest kind of money to build those businesses with. And so it was easy to predict, I think, that we would hit this period of overcapacity. And when I think about when we will come out of this recession, I do agree with Ron that, you know, by the end of this year, we'll see some easing. We'll see certainly some easing around the availability of cash and financing. But I think we're going to be in a condition of overcapacity in many industries for at least 3 to 5 years. 3 to 5 years. You know, if your glass is half empty, you can say, oh, my word, will this go on for 3 to 5 years? No, the conditions that we're in will not be, I think, as severe in the next 3 to 5 years. If your glass is half full, you'll see this as opportunity because, frankly, there'll be a lot of capacity out there to acquire. I was having lunch with one of you in the audience who was pointing out that, you know, there are a lot of restaurants on the secondary market today. That's an opportunity if you have cash. If you have cash, there's great opportunity out there in the world of overcapacity. And again, I think we'll be in that condition for 3 to 5 years. You know, we talk about a return, but nobody is clear at this point about what we're going to return to in terms of the state and capacity of the economy and the industries that we're operating in. And again, I think you can see that if your glasses half full as opportunity. Secondly, and just a minor point, because we're all observers, fortunately, I hope most of us are not players, we're about to see, in fact, we're experiencing now, in full color, in reality, even better than any reality show, we're about to experience the reasons why government shouldn't run businesses, okay? That's what's playing out at AIG. That's what's going to play out at General Motors. That's what's going to play out at Chrysler. I hope we're just observers, but I think we're also going to be in that condition for at least 24 months, until the government gets out of business. The sooner that happens, the better off we'll all be. By the way, I believe that from a monetary policy, from a stimulus policy perspective, our government is doing the right thing, is doing what it has to do to stabilize this economy. But I think in the long term, it's got to get out of business. And as many of you are aware, it's got to develop a set of sensibilities through which it recognizes that you in the room are the people who will create jobs, not, in fact, government. The government does not create jobs, but it's new business that creates jobs, particularly after a recession.